I think it's important to put this into context, and I'll give you a very brief history, since many of our colleagues in the morning have put the discussion of a number of developments, particularly in the post-war period, into context. But I think it's important to recognize that there have been a very important regional sense of regional solidarity, which is weakest of all in Asia. But is strong in Latin America. If you think about the Latin American revolutions of the middle of the 19th century, many of them were consecutive. I mean, you know, Bolivar was not just in Venezuela, and likewise, if you think about what happened in the Southern Cone, in Chile and Argentina and so on. This was all very important. But there was also a very important element, which was precisely the rise of a new phase of what can be called the imperialism of free trade. And the imperialism of free trade, which was very much following the rise of the ascendance of British manufacturing competitiveness, resulted in the British support for the so-called national revolutions of the mid 19th century in Latin America. But coming with that was a strong sense of solidarity, and this remains an important heritage, and this is why I think Roberto's earlier discussion of and the relatively recent emergence of CELAC, the community of Latin America and the Caribbean, is a very, very important development. It comes from earlier, less successful attempts. After the Cuban Revolution, there was an attempt at developing Latin American solidarity. The Cuban regime was relatively isolated, largely due to pressure from Washington. And following that, almost simultaneously with that, the development of something called OSPAL, the Organization of Solidarity of the Peoples of Africa, Asia, and Latin America, which was important. So, I think it's important to recognize that Bandung, as much as it might have been a myth, it's a very important myth. And since many of this sensibilities which have inspired the inter-Asian school and so on comes from the whole question of post-colonial analysis, this is especially important. I want to emphasize this because recently there's been a turn away from postmodernism, a very healthy turn away because of the problems of postmodernist analysis and its reliance on a particular view of linguistic philosophy. Which I certainly don't want to bore you with, but I think what is very compelling is the fact that real problems have forced themselves and many people a turn away, particularly in developing countries, a turn away from postmodernism and its various influences to a return to more realist thinking. And this, I think, most vividly, I think, climate change. Climate change is not just a construction of the mind. Climate change is not just a construction of conversations and discourses. It is a real problem. So the inability of thinking and contemporary thinking to deal with this, I think, is especially important. Now, as far as our subject is concerned today, I think it's important to recognize that the original motivation for the Millennium Development Goals was precisely to undermine the heritage which we have been talking about. Because as we were reminded earlier, coming out of Bandung, coming out of the emergence of the non-aligned movement, were a number of very important developments. The establishment of UNCTAD, the establishment of the G77 of developing countries, which now has over 130 members, but is arguably far less effective today than it used to be half a century ago. And together with that, the establishment of UNCTAD and a number of other institutions which we have spent some time referring to at least. And also following that, simultaneous with that, the establishment of the first development decade in the 1960s. The very first decade which the UN declared was the first development decade. Okay, so we have had four development decades, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, all of which had very little to show for themselves, although I think, as we were reminded earlier, there was some important progress, particularly before the 1980s, which was quite significant, not only in Latin America, but also in Asia, the decolonized parts of Asia. But in Africa, it was a very important moment also when African development actually did make some progress. If you think, regardless of what you might think about big dams, for example, the achievements were very tangible. The electrification of the Volta River, from the Volta River Dam, and so on and so forth. All these were very, very tangible gains, which I think it would be a mistake to dismiss. This was reversed. It was reversed very consciously, and Africa, Latin America, they used to talk about the lost decade in Latin America. But you actually had more than one decade which was lost, as far as Latin America is concerned. Africa, I think it is now commonplace to acknowledge that there was a lost quarter of a century from the late 1970s until the beginning of this century. So we have a very, very important turn, and this has left the world in a very different situation. So now, at the end of the Cold War, and I'll come back to this in a moment, at the end of the Cold War, you basically had a significant change in developing country relations between the North and the South, as we now term it. And you see, for example, a significant drop in ODA to developing countries, a deliberate attempt to break, to divide the so-called least developed countries from the other countries. A conscious effort to divide African countries from the other Latin American countries. All this happened during this very intense period, beginning from the Thatcher-Reagan counter-revolution of the 1980s during the 1990s, and has had very, very profound implications. So basically, after all this, there was a determined effort not to have a fifth development decade. And instead, you had not a negotiated text, but a statement which was basically prepared by a man some people might know, a former professor at Columbia University, Richard Ruggie, who basically drafted what is called the Millennium Declaration. And the Millennium Declaration was not a negotiated text. Very elegantly, nicely written, and so on and so forth, with all the correct rhetoric. But very importantly as well, it provided the watered-down basis for the Millennium Development Goals, which again was not negotiated, but basically handed as a fait accompli to member states. And a very fundamental change in relations accompanying this. I don't have time to get into all the personalities and others involved in this whole process, but it's very important to recognize all this was going on. Recognizing, for example, what was happening in Zimbabwe, the turn, the isolation of the Mugabe regime, the reversal of the commitments which were made in the early 1980s to compensate for land reforms and so on and so forth. This is very, very different from, for example, the American support for land reforms in post-war Japan, post-war Taiwan, and even in South Korea. These reforms were seen as absolutely necessary in the context of the Cold War in terms of ensuring that these countries did not move into the other camp, so to speak. So a willingness, the generosity of the Marshall Plan, in terms of rebuilding a post-war Europe, including Germany. It must be emphasized. Germany is now playing very tough with Greece, but it was unable to settle its own debt, and it was that its debt was forgiven. And all this was made possible particularly because it was important to strengthen Europe, because there was the real fear that Europe would go to the other side for reasons which we heard about earlier. So it's important to put all this into context. What I would like to do is to begin with to talk about these four themes very, very quickly, inequality, poverty, hunger, and social protection. Against the larger backdrop, because I think almost everybody agrees that that when you talk about the MDGs, most people think about poverty, and sometimes they think about hunger. Okay, but inequality is a problem which is not very much addressed in the post-2015 discourse, and also it's very important to think about the Bachelet initiative and its proposal for. On as far as social protection is concerned. Now, let me run through a lot of slides quickly. Okay, this slide basically shows you that inequality in the world was grew very rapidly from the time around the time of the Industrial Revolution until the First World War. Okay, so after the First World War, you have a decline in inequality, in national level inequalities in much of the world until 1980s. And the 1980s are another turning point, because the 1980s, I mentioned earlier, Thatcher and Reagan, but they basically lead the way. So you have then a flattening of the, no longer a decline of inequality, and then after the 1980s, an increase in inequality. Now here I'm talking about national level inequalities. And it's important to recognize this trend, because I think depending on your particular perspective, there are many ways you can interpret it. Okay, if you are you have a much more revolutionary understanding of the world, you can talk about the impact of the Bolshevik Revolution in terms of forcing the welfareist reforms which took place from the 1920s. If you have a more social democratic view of the world, you can talk about the impact of the rise of the labor movement, Polanyi's second movement, the establishment of the ILO for what that's worth, and so on and so forth, as being important during this period from the 1920s. Remember that this all happening right through all this is happening with the Great Depression in the background, the Great Crash, the so-called Gilded Age in the United States. So for those of you who read English literature, the Great Gatsby and all this, this is the context in which we're talking about. And I'm not sure what happened to this slide, but basically this slide gives you a sense of inequalities today. Now, looking at the income of the richest man compared to the national average, okay? And guess who's number one in the world? Mr. Mikhail Khodorkovsky, okay, way ahead of John D. Rockefeller the first, okay. Bill Gates looks relatively poor in comparison, and then Carnegie and the Emperor Croesus and so on and so forth. But you know, just to put things into perspective, I know some of you are very historically minded, so I'm giving you a sense of inequalities during the time of the Roman Republic or Empire, whichever you prefer. So, and this tells us what the counter-revolution can do. Okay, because Boris Yeltsin basically presided over a counter-revolution, huge depression of average income in Russia, 6-year drop in male life expectancy in Russia, 6-year drop. This is unprecedented in the last 6,000 years of world history. Okay, to have such a massive drop in human life expectancy. Okay. And that was all done in the course of less than half a decade thanks to Mr. Yeltsin and his friends. Okay. This gives you a sense of inequality changes over time. I'm not sure what's happening, sorry. Okay, this is one of my favorite charts. This is done by somebody who's been teaching in the University of Guernica. Okay, now you remember Guernica being the great mural by Picasso. But this is a chart done by somebody who teaches there, and basically it shows you inequalities in two ways. Okay, on the x-axis here, the rich are on the left, the poor are on the right. Okay, and on the diagonal axis there, rich countries are there, poor countries are there. So just imagine, if you distribute world income, the rich people in the rich countries are in that skyscraper in the corner. Okay, and the poor people in poor countries are pretty much here. You can hardly see anything here. Okay, and it gives you a sense. So the top 5% in India, as rich and obscene as some of them are, what is this $1 billion residence by Mr. Advani? No, Ambani. You have a lot of obscenity, but even then, if you take the top 5% in India, okay, the top 5% is still lower than the bottom 5% in the United States. Okay, just to give you a sense of what income distribution is like. So you see, the thing is that, you know, that last year, for the first time in recent times, an economist became a bit of a pop star, you know, Mr. Thomas Piketty, young, good-looking Frenchman, speaking with accented English and so on and so forth. And he is, you have to, even if you pay, you can't even get into his public lectures. Okay, now what? Suddenly, there's a huge interest in inequality. I almost lost my job 10 years ago when I joined the UN and I published a report on inequality. I was told that I was promoting class war. Okay, this was the view. Okay, it just shows you that how within a relatively short period of time, circumstances have changed, and it's now legitimate to talk about inequality. I won't go through all these things. I also want to emphasize that crisis can be an opportunity for many things. The Great Depression was an opportunity for Roosevelt to bring about the very significant changes in the United States, yeah, which have significantly changed the shape, not only the United States and arguably much of the rest of the world. But this last crisis has actually worsened inequalities even in the United States and in Europe. Especially in the United States and in Europe, okay, for reasons which I don't have time to elaborate on. Let me quickly now move, after that short history of inequality, to poverty. Okay, this MDG 1 target, as I think Roberto mentioned, I think let's put it in perspective. Okay, the MDG, the Millennium Development, I know there are many people who are more interested in the history of art and so on and so forth, but the Millennium Development Goals, the number one goal refers to the eradication of poverty, the halving of poverty in the world, halving of the share of poor in the world. Okay, so there's a lot of stuff which was going on during the 1990s, which actually represents momentum which had built up from the 1980s. Very importantly, for example, the Cairo Conference on Population was very important in establishing a much more ambitious goal than the MDG on poverty. Copenhagen, the Social Summit, again reiterated this. Beijing Platform for Action, the World Food Summit the following year. All this, so you basically had a very unambitious MDG 1A on poverty, which comes out of it. And I would also argue that basically because of the way poverty has been defined by MDG 1, you have a number of methodological problems which I won't bore you with right now, but for those of you who are interested, we have written a great deal of it. And in fact, Mr. Zelik, the former president of the World Bank, officially complained to the United Nations because of a report which we published, which an unknown paper called the Deccan Herald Can you imagine Mr. Zelik citing the Deccan Herald to file this complaint we were going to have this launch event in mid-January 2010. The Haitian earthquake took place. I thought it'd be in terribly bad taste to just go on as if nothing had happened. So I canceled the launch. But we had regional launches. So the regional launch was supposed to be in Delhi at the end of January. I went there, and I was foolish enough to think that there are a lot of Indian experts on poverty. I thought that Indian experts might be interested in discussing poverty in the world. So I said, why not have a panel of Indian experts on poverty to discuss poverty in the world? And they came, and nobody discussed poverty in the world. They got into very esoteric debates about poverty in India. Okay, so it's an interesting debate. So what happened was this journalist writes this story, and he calls it UN chastises World Bank poverty numbers. And that became the basis for that, and Mr. Zelik hit back in a number of other ways, which I won't get into right now. But basically, there are huge problems by taking a monetary definition. 30 cents we heard earlier, later became a dollar a day, many of you have heard. Right now, this has it's been adjusted recently to about $1.80, $1.78, I think. Is the latest estimate. But it's hugely problematic because once upon a time, poverty was defined as the amount of income which you need to try to avoid becoming hungry. Now, that original definition doesn't matter. You can have food prices going up, you can have poverty going down pretty much at the same time because you have monetized the definition. And you just adjust it by other means. Now, let me move on. The last name there is a man named Surjit Bala, who used to work for the World Bank. He is an enthusiastic supporter of Mr. Modi and Mr. Jetli in the US, in the India. But he actually said that. Can you imagine? He said the World Bank exaggerates the amount of poverty in the world to keep itself in business. Okay, so this is this is a right wing critic, okay, not a left wing critic, who says this. Anyway, let me move on very quickly. All these measures do not even take account of inflation, including inflation of the U.S. So it really the numbers do not mean very much. Okay, I just want to emphasize this. These are numbers from Indonesia. I just want to show you how sensitive the definition of poverty is. Okay, so you take, if poverty is 0.56 cents, you get a poverty rate in Indonesia, which is at that time about 19%. Okay, now if you just adjust it to add 14 cents, okay, and you have 0.70, the number of poor people more than doubles to 43. You have to sit here. I can't read. I've been told. I think I'm running out of time, so I better speed up. Okay. What we have is a situation where these numbers are all very much decided by the World Bank. Okay. So some of you may remember about 8 years ago, there was a professor, I think, at Oxford or something like that, who wrote a book called Bottom Billion. Almost within days after the book came out, the number of poor people in the world went up to 1.4 billion. Okay? And so, why? Because there was a recalculation. So, you know, it went up to 1.4 billion. And then you can have another calculation and it can go down and up. It's a bit almost like a yo-yo, okay? Because methodological problems and a whole host of other problems come up. So let me just, anyway, just remind you that you can I mean, if you're completely cynical about the whole process, you can abolish poverty simply by adjusting the poverty line. Okay, right now, we find that almost 80%, yeah, 4 out of 5 people who are deemed to be poor by the bank are living in the countryside. Okay, so the problem is a very, very serious problem. And I think it's very important for us to look at what are the debates right now. And one debate which is going on not only in the world but also in China is that forget about all these small farmers. These small farmers are basically uncompetitive. They will never ever become competitive. Forget about them. You know, move them out. Move them to the urban areas or somewhere else. Move them out of agriculture. Basically, rely on some big commercial farms. Okay, and this view is being promoted and is gathering support. Not originally, as usual, started by in the U.S. And it's called the eco-modernist view. Okay, so it claims to be eco-friendly. So, you know, if you want to try to fix ecological problems related to agriculture, don't try to fiddle with these small farmers. They are so messy, you can't deal with them. Okay, what you need to do is allow the big farms to take over, produce in a big scale, and so on and so forth. So, okay, if there's some good agricultural land going on to be had in Africa, let's open some big farms there. Okay, and global warming is going to take place. Fine, that will increase. Global warming will increase farm output in temperate zones. So the length of the breeding period in North America, for example, will be lengthened because you will have shorter winters. And the same thing could be said of the steppes and so on and so forth. So this is the new thinking. And they will be the first to tell you there are very difficult trade-offs to be had. But this is the only way we can save the world. Okay, so all this is done not simply about commercializing. It's not as straightforward, you know, big farmers are going to solve the problem. This is done in terms of, there's a lot of language about, you know, being concerned about the environment, about sustainability, and so on and so forth. So, you know, let us beware of slogans, yeah? and try to look very carefully at what all this implies. Now, I just want to mention here very quickly some of the favorite slogans of the anti-poverty movement. One of the books I published a couple of years ago was a book called Is Good Governance Good for Development? And basically, you can guess from the title what my views are. But there was a view that the big problem right now with these developing countries is that you have to save them from themselves. These people are just, you know, they're all these nice code words, yeah, all rent seekers, and about a couple of decades, you know, rent seeking was analysis of rent seeking was going to solve the problems of the world and so on and so forth. What you really need is good governance, but the problem is that good people who are seriously good about good governance cannot stay in power. So, and you can't, and you're supposed to be also democratic. So you have a real problem. So I think it's very important to recognize that now increasingly in many developing countries, you have leaders who are anointed, okay? And they have different incentive systems. They are not going to be corrupt in the usual sense of making a lot of money from your own country. You get seduced, you know, if you are rewarded, if you do well, you get, you know, we'll give you a job in the UN, like me, or maybe in the World Bank or something like that. You'll be well rewarded, okay? This is and you'll find these people, okay? President Jokowi, for example, has got, some of the people there are from the last regime. It's almost indistinguishable, okay? And these are technocrats, okay, PhDs from good Western or Australian universities and so on and so forth, you know, moved to have international experience from working in the World Bank and elsewhere, and so on and so forth. You take somebody like the president of Côte d'Ivoire, okay, head of the Africa program at the IMF. You look at the former head of the UNDP, former finance minister of Turkey, and before that, World Bank vice president, and on. The list is a long list. Yeah? It's not. I'm just giving you a couple of names of people who might be recognized, but the list is a long list. And this is a form of corruption. Let's face it, you know. But anyway, time is running out. Microcredit, you all know about how wonderful microcredit is supposed to be, to saving the world. Just for your information, recently, Atiur Rahman, the central bank governor of Bangladesh, has come out with figures showing that 96% of the credit of total credit in Bangladesh. And Bangladesh is supposed to be the paragon of excellence as far as microcredit is concerned. 96% is captured by less than 10% of the population. Okay, less than 10% of borrowers, certainly not population. Less than 10% of borrowers. Now the situation in many other countries is pretty much the same, if not worse. But it's important to recognize that, you know, despite all the microcredit efforts and so on, you'll find very, very limited. I'm not against microcredit, but let's put things into perspective. Likewise, property rights is the other big deal. Yeah? One of the friends of some of us, Issa Shivji, he spent about 5 or 6 years of his life preparing 27 volumes looking at land tenure arrangements in Tanzania. And then the development cooperation minister of Norway comes along. She was born in Arusha because her father was trying to convert people in Arusha. So she comes along. She said, "I have this strong attachment to Tanzania. I'll give you so much money and bring in Anando de Soto." So don't worry. South-South cooperation has been appropriated by Washington and other sources. You know, Anando de Soto is well known in Egypt, well known in Tanzania, and so on and so forth. You know, all this is happening. So we are, in a sense, behind time. Yeah, we are not keeping up with what is happening in the real world as far as all this is concerned. Now, the last point I want to make is that relationship between poverty and hunger. The definition of poverty and hunger, that link has been abandoned. Let me move very, very quickly because I've been running out of time. The MDG on poverty is supposed to have been achieved by 2008. Okay, as far as hunger is concerned, I doubt it will be achieved. Partly because, at least while I'm still in the FAO, maybe because I'm looking at the numbers and I don't believe that it's going to, it has been achieved. But still, there are almost 800 people who are chronically hungry. What does it mean to be chronically hungry? It means that you don't get enough carbohydrates, okay? We're not talking about a balanced diet or a healthy diet or anything like that. You just don't have enough carbohydrates to work. So that's why poor people are considered to be lazy, because they don't have enough to eat to work. Okay, so this is very important, you know, because we have a lot of myths about why people are, you know, these people are poor because they are lazy, but you know, maybe it's the other way around. Maybe they are lazy because they are poor, you know, and that's precisely what is important for us to recognize. But in any case, we have a lot of people who remain hungry in the world. But besides that, there are lots more people, I would estimate well over 2 billion people, who are not hungry, okay, but who suffer from one kind of malnutrition or another. And I'm talking about undernutrition, okay, and usually micronutrient deficiencies. And many of these micronutrient deficiencies are irreversible. If you do not get certain minerals or vitamins or trace elements during the first 1,000 days of life, from conception to the age of two, you are going to be affected adversely through either physical underdevelopment or cognitive underdevelopment. These are facts. Women have different needs than men. Throughout from puberty to menopause, women need far more iron than men. So they're more likely to be anemic. So you really need a very, very different approach if you're serious about dealing with problems of nutrition. And it's not simply a question of making sure you have enough, conditional cash transfers. Okay? You know, you can give any amount of money to people, and if they don't know what they need, so you really need much, much more well-designed initiatives, and it's very important to think about that in this connection. Let me just run through, these are just numbers to show that the situation, much of the progress as far as reducing hunger is concerned is in East Asia and Southeast Asia, Latin America, and perhaps the Caribbean. I'm not so sure about the Caribbean. I don't know how the numbers seem to look as good as they do as far as the Caribbean is concerned, particularly considering what has happened in Haiti. One of the few apologies Bill Clinton has ever made is to the Haitian people, because he basically killed the rice growing in Haiti by insisting that Haiti sign up for free trade. Haitian rice growers couldn't compete, and they basically basically died. Now, uneven trends. Let me just skip this. I'll skip all this. Okay, as you know, from between 2006 and 2008, food prices went up. Okay, and the difference between food prices going up globally and food prices going up at the local markets is significant. It's reflected by this. And then, why do I want to mention this? Because as you know, there has been a determined effort to eliminate subsidies. Fuel subsidies and food subsidies. Those are the two major forms of subsidies. Okay, you want to eliminate fuel subsidies, it doesn't mean very much when fuel prices have come down so much in recent times. But food subsidies is a different story altogether. Okay, and food price subsidies are being eliminated all over the world as we speak. Okay, and the reason why this is important is because, as you can see here, there is a huge disparity between global prices and local prices. Now, there are other factors, of course. Very little of the world's rice output is actually traded. Okay, less than 10%. Unlike say wheat and maize. But having said that, I think it's very important for us to recognize the importance of food subsidies. And we were reminded of this only too recently. The so-called Arab Spring was largely because of the squeezing of food subsidies. What's his name? Mohammed, the guy who died. The peddler who died. He actually says this very, very explicitly before he died. Okay, now let me just run through some more here. I'll skip all this stuff on food. I think it's very important to recognize that the biggest problem in the world is really problems of underemployment. Most people in developing countries cannot afford to be completely unemployed, okay, given the lack of any kind of social support. So that's not an option. So what do people do? They basically are usually typically underemployed. And in many countries, there is no unemployment or very low figures of unemployment because there are very few people who are completely unemployed. Okay? Most people work a few hours a week at least, at least to survive. And this, I think, reflects itself. So very often when we look at data, we are actually missing the real picture because of the way data is constructed. Okay, let me just run through the case for social protection. Okay, one of the better things which has happened recently is the initiative by Juan Somavia, who was then the Director General of ILO, who uh, who commissioned, sponsored a commission led by Michelle Bachelet in between her first and second presidential term. She recommended a social protection floor, and the evidence is very strong that more than anything else, social protection has a very important impact. These numbers are from Mexico, these numbers actually are from South Africa. I don't know how they crept into the heading says something about Mexico, but these are South African figures. Very, very okay. If you want to understand why ANC continues to get more than 60% of the vote, this is the reason why. Okay. No matter what corruption there is going on and so on and so forth, at the end of the day, it's very important to recognize this. Even in Europe, social protection has been very important in reducing poverty. There are many forms of social protection. Right now, the World Bank and others are trying to reduce the social protection to one issue, and that issue is conditional cash transfers. But it's very important to recognize that even in Asia, where people say, oh, there's no social protection, there has historically always been social protection. Where I may disagree with Samir is that, in fact, in China, social protection has been greatly decimated over the last few decades, and I think it's important to recognize that. I'm not suggesting to return to the old forms of social protection, but there need to be new forms of social protection redesigned appropriate for our times. And some of this is happening. I'd be happy to talk about my own experience with the former Vice Minister for Poverty Eradication, Fan Xiaojian. These are all details. It's all in your packet, so you can read about it. There's no need to get into all these details now. Let me see. Oh yeah, this is basically a question of political. I mean, my point here is a very simple point. At the end of the day, whether or not you get any social protection is a question of political will. But I think, and this is why something which Roberto said, which is very important, that ultimately, in a parliamentary system, you are deal-making all the time. And deal-making means what some people would call corruption. Okay? And this is the challenge. Whether it's in Indonesia or Brazil or any other place, if you look, you know, one of the greatest critics of leakages in India, on Indian, public distribution system, is a man named Jean Dres. Okay? But Jean Dres came out and endorsed the National Food Security Act, as well as before that, the NREGA, the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. Of course there will be leakages. Of course local politicians will try to skim some of it off. But the question is, do you throw the baby out with the bathwater? And the kinds of necessary things which are done, unfortunately, which have to be done in a situation where political clientelism is an understandable response to the political structures you have inherited. And nobody talks about corruption in Washington. There are more than 250,000 registered lobbyists. Okay, more than 250,000 registered lobbyists. Okay, nobody talks about that. You know, because it's all considered legitimate. It's legal because you have registered. Okay. Just moving on. I'm not a great advocate of corruption. Some of you might remember me. I was put on the front page of a magazine, which is now happily defunct, called Asia Week, with a red glow because of what I was campaigning for as far as corruption was concerned. I'm not advocating corruption by any means, but I think it's very important to understand all this in perspective. There are possible reforms, and this is why the Addis Ababa conference coming up in July offers opportunities in terms of improved taxation and so on and so forth. Most developing countries actually collect very little. Germany collects 53% of national income through taxation system. Many of the poorest countries collect less than 10%. You have some of these countries, say a country like Tanzania, is that now, after South Africa and Ghana, Tanzania is the third largest gold producer in Africa. Can anybody here tell me how much Tanzania gets what the net revenue is for Tanzania from gold mining? Guess. Well, the answer is negative. Tanzania subsidizes gold mining by foreign miners. Yeah? Why? Because we cannot afford to be corrupt, right? So when you subsidize foreign miners, of course you're not considered corrupt. Right? I mean, this is not a joke. Yeah? It's completely serious. Okay? Now, the point I want to make is that social protection is possible even in relatively poor developing countries, and we have shown this in various other studies as well, and that the fiscal space does exist. But right now, unfortunately, much of many African countries right now get its advice on taxation from the OECD, which is the club of developed countries. They are not going to improve their taxation if all they are interested in is trying to evade tax havens. Of course, the most tax havens are supposed to be in the Caribbean, but in fact, the biggest tax havens are actually in the US and in London. Okay, they're not out in British Cayman Islands or some other part of the Caribbean. Okay, finally, there are now 17 so-called sustainable development goals which have been proposed. You can read all about them in the paper. But I just want to focus on this final slide to emphasize that that there are some problems with the sustainable development goals. There is still no clear development focus. What they mean by development is simply reducing poverty, or eradicating hunger. There is no positive view of development which you had in the development decades. A second point, I think, is that in trying to make it universal, because the MDGs were all directed at developing countries, in trying to make everything universal, you end up with, it becomes so wishy-washy, it's neither here nor there. The third problem is that the emphasis is very decidedly now on sustainability. And not that sustainability is unimportant, and I certainly do agree with a greater emphasis on sustainability, but there is much less, it reinforces the lack of development content. There are also now so many targets that you everything becomes a gray mass. You don't see focus, you don't see priorities, you don't see targets. Fifth, there's no treatment of inequality, and there is a strong technocratic bias, which has its advantages, but I fear ultimately is going to be not only flawed, but very, very problematic. So with this, let me thank you for your attention. I'm sorry to the chair for taking too much time.